and I can edit out the beginning. And I hit the record button.
You're going to get my arm.
Oh, yeah, that's not good. And we're streaming. Maybe.
All right, everyone.
Hi, Facebook.
Hey, Facebook. Yep, looks
there's,
like we...
There's your arm.
Hey, look at that, my arm.
Okay.
And there you are.
Here we go. In
fantastic.
3, 2, 1. First, I'm going to try this. Yeah, I can never tell if that thing worked or not. I'm going to do it one more time.
I got program up here.
This is Ham Radio Now, episode number 399¾. Getting started with DMR. I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and today I'm going to learn about DMR. And Wirecast detected feet. Okay, I don't care. I'm going to learn about DMR today. And today, I have a guest in studio. Hi, Darren.
Hey, how are you doing?
I'm good.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, thank you for coming. So, Darren is AJ6BL. He is with Aries LAX. He is an assistant emergency coordinator and knows a little bit more, or a lot more, about DMR. And so I invited him today to come and get me up to speed because I have this radio and I have no idea how to use it.
Yeah, well, I won't say I'm an expert or anything. I just got started about a week ago myself. So, you know, please excuse any errors that I may, you know, tell you.
Okay. Well, at least I know we got it working. So if it works, you did better than I did.
Okay. Okay, so, cool.
So let's jump right in. I'm going to share my screen here, and we'll talk a little bit about what is DMR.
All right.
So
sounds good.
What is DMR?
Well, digital mobile radio. I know it's rocket science there. So DMR is digital mobile radio. We'll start with my little slideshow here. So kind of a disclaimer. It comes from a commercial background. So there are, you know, it's been adopted by the amateur radio community. And a lot of the functionality may seem unnecessary. It may seem gratuitous, but it's rooted in commercial use. So, you know, there's a lot of things here that we're going to go over. And, you know, most hams are going to say, well, why do I need all this extra stuff? Well, somebody needed it, and then we adopted it and made it work for us. So, and with all that added functionality comes added complexity, as you and I realized this morning trying to get to get our radios to talk to one another. So I just want to go over a couple benefits of DMR. You know, one of the things is you get a wide range of communication on a single frequency. You can talk locally, regionally. You can talk to people around the world. And you can talk to people on, you know, sort of topic-specific channels. Which we'll go over. The multiple conversations can also happen simultaneously on a single frequency. Actually, only two conversations can happen simultaneously. There is a limit, but you know, it's more than you can get on a regular analog channel. It has the it has the capability of having better audio quality. I won't tell you it's always better. Some people sound worse. But, you know, when you have a good DMR connection, you know, the quality is really good. It has a text messaging capability, which I have yet to use, but, you can send text messages. So, you know, kids these days will have a blast with DMR. It allows the use of a hotspot, and, we had to set up a hotspot today to get our radios to work properly. So that was very handy. You're less likely to encounter jammers. I don't know this as a fact, but I would assume because all of your transmissions are logged into a database, and the second you key up your radio, you end up, you know, getting your call sign put on the internet. I would really not want to be a jammer in that situation because we'll figure out who you are really quickly. And it's an open standard defined by ETSI, and it's European. I cannot remember off the top of my head what ETSI stands for. David, do you?
Nope.
Do you remember?
I got nothing.
Okay. Okay. I'm sure somebody out there remembers and we could look it up on the internet, but just knowing that it's defined by ETSI is, but it's an open standard, unlike D-Star. So all the hackers and computer programmers out there, you can write your own software and your own, you know, code plugs and modifications and stuff like that, which I ended up having to do when I broke my DMR radio, which is actually how I learned about a lot of this stuff. It's nothing like breaking a radio to teach you how it works. And it's low cost compared to D-Star. So since D-Star is proprietary, it's an ICOM licensed technology there. You know, I can get a DMR radio for less than $100 on Amazon. And actually, I think mine was like $65 or $70 or something like that. So, you know, good entry cost there. There are drawbacks. You need good reception, as we found this morning. Yep. We both were able to hear the repeater, but transmitting to the repeater was a bit of a challenge. And unlike analog, poor receptions means you don't get anything. You don't get any audio whatsoever. Whereas, you know, with analog, if it's, you know, fuzzy in the background, you can still kind of hear something. But yeah, with DMR and other digital modes, if it's not connected well, you get dropouts. There is forward error correction, which mitigates this, but obviously not completely. There's some latency. Duplexing with DMR is a bit complicated if you want to, you know, listen to what you're saying simultaneously. There's going to be at least 60 milliseconds of latency, and that's pretty audible to the human ear. And actually, it's probably even going to be more than 60 milliseconds because there's a lot of networking and, you know, stuff like that that goes on. So you can't really, you know, listen to what you're saying at the same time. And I'm going to highlight this again, added complexity. It is not the simplest thing to get set up if you're not familiar with, even when you are familiar with all of the little intricacies, it's still very complex. And I made a little illustration to show that. So here's analog radio. When you're talking to a repeater, you've got your transmit frequency, you might have a PL tone that you need to program in, and then there's the audio signal that you transmit over the air. Same thing for the receive. Maybe you have a receive offset, so you have a different, slightly different frequency. Maybe you have a PL tone you have to set up to you know, listen to, and again, there's your audio signal. Here's what I kind of made for DMR for the same.
Wow. Yeah. That looks really complicated.
It's not intuitive. It takes you a little bit of time to kind of wrap your head around all of these, what I like to call abstract containers. And I will go through this in more detail in a minute, but I just wanted to kind of show, you know, analog, a couple of things you need to know, DMR, and probably D-Star as well. I don't know. I've never played with D-Star, so I don't really have any experience there. I'm guessing it's a little bit easier than DMR. So I just want to go over some key terms and concepts that are kind of important to wrap your head around, and we'll go into more detail about them. But a DMR network is important to understand. So it's an operating software for quote-unquote master servers. So basically the servers that are connected to the repeaters that you're going to talk to. And they're participating in a worldwide infrastructure network of amateur radio digital voice systems. The definition here is courtesy of Brandmeister's wiki page, so I did not write that. You know, it's the software that runs DMR, and there's multiple DMR networks used by different repeaters around the world. I think the two primary ones are Brandmeister, and then there's DMR Mark, MARC. They have different settings and things like that you have to be aware of. Time slots, and I'm going to go into this in a little bit more detail in the next couple slides here, but just a quick overview. It's a segmented amount of time for a data packet to transmit. DMR uses two time slots. Each of them are 30 milliseconds each. If you're familiar from, you know, taking your ham exams, with TDMA, time division multiple access, that's the technology that's being employed here. It's two time slots. So that means you can have two simultaneous conversations, at the same time on a single frequency, which you cannot do on analog because you'll get a pileup. Your radio ID. This is pretty important. I actually had to mentioned that to David the other day when he said his radio wasn't working.
Yeah, I needed help with that for sure. I could listen really well.
You can listen to anything you want, but if you want to transmit, it's important to have a radio ID. When you key up your radio, it's going to transmit that radio ID, and that's actually what's going to tell the repeater or, you know, the other radio you're talking to that you're set up for this network. And it takes about 24 hours to get one, so if anyone here is getting their radio set up for the first time, I'd suggest go ahead and get your subscriber ID set up sooner than later. I can give you guys the webpage to that. We can put that in the chat or something like that at some point. It's a unique ID number assigned to each member of the DMR network. It must be obtained before you can operate on a DMR frequency. And so that's an important one. a talk group. We'll discuss more about these. Oops. Oh, sorry. I hit the button twice there. But anyways, a talk group is a discussion group typically segmented by region. So you've got local talk group, state, country, global, and others, or subject matter. There's an MCOM talk group. So emergency communications has its own talk group. And it's got a specific code associated with it. So you got to be aware that each of these talk groups has a number that you need to program into your radio.
So when you say talk group, there's the MCOM talk group, we'll have to subscribe to that. Is that a local thing, a national thing, a regional thing?
I think the way it's done is it would be throughout the entire repeater network. So if you want to say that it's 9999 is the MCOM talk group. Mm-hmm. If you're on any Brandmeister DMR network enabled repeater and you set up your talk group for MCOM, it doesn't matter where you are, you should be able to hear that conversation.
Hear and talk to them.
Yeah, as well. And talk to them. Got it. And chime in. Got so now you can make your own talk group. You can, you know, have the Ham Radio Now talk group and, you know, set it up on your local repeater. And anybody who's aware of that code that you've specified can join that conversation as long as they're on the same DMR network.
Got it. I know the Workbench podcast guys, they have 31 something or other.
Yeah.
And they have one set up as well.
Yeah. There's a whole bunch of them. And it gets kind of figured out by, you know, the sysops of the repeater itself. They'll determine which ones they want to have active all the time. And then, you know, which ones will be dynamic. And we'll get into that in a minute. Something to kind of understand is the concept of a digital contact. Now, it's basically an abstract container for a talk group. So they're almost interchangeable in their functionality. The digital contact will be part of the software that you set up. We'll have, you know, a digital contact area in a drop-down menu somewhere. You'll set up a digital contact, and basically all it is this is the talk group that I want to assign to this digital contact. And we can look through some of the software later if we want to play with that a little more. And then you have your receive group, which is another abstract container, but it is used to assign one or more talk groups. So you can only transmit to one talk group at a time, but you can actually listen to multiple talk groups at the same time. So say you want to be on your, you know, local talk group, but you always want to listen to the MCOM talk group just in case, you know, some emergency happens. You can set up in your software that for that digital for that channel, again, we'll get all these different terms. For that channel, you can transmit to the single talk group of local, but you can listen to local as well as MCOM. And I think there's no limit to how, well, maybe there's a limit in certain software. So send to one, listen to many, but it gets a little confusing because if you're listening to MCOM and you're on your local channel, nobody's going to hear you on the MCOM channel if you transmit, only the people on local, so you'll have to switch to a different channel.
And you'll hear all the multiple conversations at the same time?
Simultaneously, yeah. So if there's two conversations going on, it's going to get really confusing. The way I set up my radio is I have one receive group for every talk group. I don't have any that are, you know, set up with multiple receive groups in them.
Easier to manage that way.
Yeah, yeah. It depends on your code plug. Some of them, like I saw in your code plug that you have for your radio, that they have multiple receive groups in the same channel, which, you know, again, who knows where somebody's talking unless they specify what talk group they're actually talking on. Maybe they're, you know, you might think you're talking to them and you're not. Here's some more concepts and terms. Oop, I keep hitting that button twice. Color code. This one kind of threw me for a loop when I first got into it, but it's basically the PL tone for digital radio. It's, you know, their numbers, it's a single digit number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever. I've only seen a couple times where they've used any other number than one, on the Papa network, which is, you know, what you and I are members of Papa. And I'd like to thank them for letting us, kind of use their, use their system today, to test all this out. They've, you know, I think number one and number three are some of the color codes they use. And then a channel, I'd mentioned that before. It's an abstract container used to set up the transmit and receive frequencies, your talk groups, your receive groups, your color code, and the time slot, plus more. So basically what you're going to do is on your software, you're going to have, I don't know, I think I have 350 channels on my radio, and those channels will basically have all of the settings programmed into each channel.
So it's just like any other frequency that you'd program on an analog radio. It has all the bits and pieces that you would need to be able to actually send and receive a conversation.
Right. But since there's so many settings, yeah. You know, compared to just, you know, your right. PL tone and your receive and send frequencies. Yeah, it's a channel.
Got it.
It's actually one of the terms that makes sense. Then you have your zones. So being that I have 350 channels set up on my radio, there has to be a way to make sense out of that. So what you can do is you get these abstract containers, and I keep using that term, but that's what makes sense to me. I think of Russian dolls. You know, you've got all of these little things all kind of contained in themselves. It's used for organizing related groups of channels. So if you're talking to a specific repeater, and on that repeater there's, say, five different talk groups, well, you're going to need a zone set up for that repeater, and then those talk groups will be in that zone. But you don't want to have 350 channels that you're panning through every day just trying to get to, you know, your local repeater. It gets a little confusing.
Right.
Criteria is another term that you'll see in there. And admin criteria are the rules specified to allow transmission. In-call criteria are the rules for specifying reception, allowing reception. I have mine set to always because I don't really have any reason not to, but you can set it up so that if somebody else is transmitting on that same time slot, it won't let you transmit. It's kind of a courteous thing, so you're not going to step on anybody. But it also kind of slows down the radio when you have lots of criteria, because, you know, if you're on a net meeting, like I was on the Papa DMR net meeting last night, and people are all trying to check in. If you have, you know, to only transmit when the time slot is available, you'll never get into the check-in.
Oh, because everybody's trying at the same time.
Right, everyone's trying at the same time, so there's never a time that time slot is open. So, but I'm sure that the right courteous thing to do is just set it to only transmit when it's a free frequency. Your code plug. This is sort of the template that you'll potentially download from, you know, your repeater network. It's a radio-specific pre-configured file, or you can build your own, with related information needed to enable communication with your DMR network repeater. And like Papa's website, you go there, and you can download the code plug for your radio specifically. There wasn't one for my radio. I bought the Radiodity GD77. It was sort of the Amazon.com special. You know, it was less than $100. And I went to the Papa Network, and of course, you know, there wasn't a code plug, but I went into their forums, and somebody had written one, and I downloaded that and sort of learned.
So they just didn't have it posted on the code plug page.
Right. And actually the person hadn't updated it in a while, and it didn't work right off the bat. And then I broke the radio, so I thought it was misconfigured, and it wasn't misconfigured. It was the fact that I did something to the radio that stopped it from working properly. And then you'll see the term reflector, and this kind of screwed me up for a while. I didn't really understand what it was, but it allows the different DMR networks to talk to each other. So if there's a reflector set up on your DMR network, it will, if say you're on a Brandmeister network like Papa is, and there's a channel that you want to share that's also on the DMR Mark network, they use a reflector to allow those two networks to talk to one another. I haven't heard anyone on anything like that yet, so I don't have any experience with it, but apparently that's what it does.
Yeah, reflector is something I've heard from D-Star before.
Yeah.
D-Star, the reflectors are kind of like your zones and channels.
Okay.
That allow you to, you know, talk into a different group that is broadcast over, you know, near and far and whatever. That's where I've heard that terminology before.
Yeah. And again, you know, I'm just learning about this stuff myself, so yep. I'm no expert. I'm just trying to help others where I've stumbled. And then there is roaming capabilities with DMR. Now, it's not with every radio. Unfortunately, right now it's limited to Motorola and Hytera radios, mm-hmm. but it gives you the ability to, they can sense their location and proximity to a repeater and then automatically switch frequencies and then connect to the closest one. So if you're driving around town and you have your roaming on, it can say, oh, I'm near, you know, the Santa Monica repeater, and it'll automatically switch over.
It'll just hear it and find it.
Yeah.
That's another, yeah. D-Star has a kind of a similar function with the new radios where it can go out and know where you are and can figure itself.
Yeah, I find that D-Star, from what I've heard, is a little more user-friendly than DMR. There's a little, you know, but with that, you're also limited. It's proprietary, so you can't really, you know, customize it as much as you can with DMR. So time slots. This is a important, you know, thing to understand. You have two time slots, and each of those time slots are 60 milliseconds. So, or sorry, 30 milliseconds. So you've got, if you can see my mouse here, right? Mm-hmm. Time slot one, and then time slot two. Now, within each of those time slots is going to be a data packet, and that's going to contain the audio that you're transmitting or the text message that you're going to transmit. And each of these time slots, so every talk group has its own time slot. If you're on the local talk group, for example, I believe that's on time slot two. If you're on the worldwide time talk group, that'll be on time slot one. And this is sort of what allows you to have these two conversations going simultaneously. They're ping-ponging back and forth. So it's time slot one gets transmitted, then time slot two, time slot one, time slot two. Each of them transmit for 30 milliseconds, and that's why when I said latency, mentioned latency earlier, why I said it's going to be at least 60 milliseconds of latency. Well, it's going to be 30 milliseconds, then another 30 milliseconds, and then your time slot comes back up. So you're going to have 60 milliseconds of time passing before your time slot happens again. So if you're listening to the same frequency you're transmitting on, it will take 60 milliseconds before your voice shows up to a receiver.
So it's almost like there's like a digital voice recorder that captures what you say, and then it plays it back, and captures what you say and plays it back, and that's what happens.
Yeah, it's kind of like a little buffer, you know, and then it packetizes that audio and then sends it off, and then it does the next channel and, you know, time slot and back and forth and back and forth. So it alternates between both time slots, and it allows multiple conversations to happen at the same time. And, you know, unlike analog, you can have two conversations going at the same time. But one of the caveats is that timing is very important. And I say that because this is where I screwed things up on my radio. I did what most people do when you get into trouble with something, and I did a reset, thinking, well, you know, if I do a hard reset and I start from scratch, you know, maybe I can fix my problem. Unfortunately, with the Radiodity GD77 specifically, if you do a hard reset, it screws up the internal timing, and I ended up having to get a hex editor and downloading the flash from the radio and reprogramming all kinds of stuff on a very low level, and it was educational, but it was also
so essentially you bricked the radio.
Oh yeah, definitely. Bricked the radio. Awesome. But luckily I was recovered. You know, I was able to recover it. There was a really cool website which I'll show you with you guys share with you guys later. That, you know, walked me through this. Talk groups. So talk groups are important. They're a discussion group, typically segmented by region, local, state, you know, country, global, whatever, or subject matter. And they have a specific code associated with it. They're basically a method of organizing traffic that allows an operator to focus on one subject matter and ignore unrelated conversation. Being that you can set up multiple talk groups in a receive group, that can kind of throw you off. So that's why I said earlier, I like to set up one talk group and one receive group per channel, so it operates the way I'd expect it to. And I can ignore unrelated conversation. And they're associated with a specific time slot. So you're going to want to look at your repeater network, your DMR networks, settings, and find out which time slot your talk group is associated with, because when you're building your code plug, it's really important to know which time slot the talk group is associated with. And only one talk group can be active on a time slot at any time. So one of the things that we ran into last night when we were trying our DMR together was that there was a lot of conversations going on both time slots, and we were on the local talk group, which was on time slot 2, but there was another conversation going on another talk group that we weren't hearing that was using up that time slot. So it's just important. You can only get 2 conversations going on. You can't have 5 conversations going on. I don't know why specifically, other than maybe added latency, they don't have more time slots associated with a frequency. You probably could have more time slots associated with the frequency. It would add more latency and there'd be more, you know, other complications there, but just something to realize that, you know, you can only have one conversation going on per time slot at any time.
Which there's only 2 set up.
And there's only 2.
Got it.
Yeah. So the number codes that are associated with your talk group will be the same within the DMR network that you're associated with, but may not be the same between the different DMR networks. I just wanted to mention that. So if you're on a repeater that's on Brandmeister and then you switch over to a repeater that's on DMR Mark, those talk groups may not be the same. That you may need to, unless there's a reflector between them, in which case then it, you know, doesn't, it translates that, I believe, or somehow.
So it may have the same name, but it may not have the same numbering.
Right. Yeah. So your you know, California talk group may be off by some numbers. And they may not, but, you know, I think there's associations out there that are trying to standardize all of this stuff, but still it's important to realize that when you're setting up your code plug. And the Parrot talk group is pretty important, I've found, to test, you know, test your operation of your radio. It basically records a message and then plays it back to you a few seconds later, so you can make sure that, you know, everything's working without bothering everybody on the repeater.
Yeah, that was cool when I got it to work.
Yeah.
It wasn't so cool when I didn't get it to work.
No, then it gets very confusing, and I don't really remember what setting we changed to make it work. But
well, I didn't have the number in. I think, first of all, I didn't have my ID registered, and that helped a lot.
Yeah, that definitely.
And then there was something about private.
Yes, Parrot is a private talk group, so it's not a group's. Again, I'm going to mess up the terminology here, mm-hmm. but you can make private contacts and you can make group contacts. It was a private contact that we needed to set up,
right,
instead of a group contact. And then there's what's called static talk groups and dynamic talk groups. And static talk groups are groups that are active on the repeater all the time. So if you tune into a static talk group, you can hear the traffic on it without having to do anything. It'll just, you know, start. You'll start hearing everything. And a dynamic talk group are only active on the repeater when you've triggered it by keying up your radio. So there may be, you know, lots of talk groups on the repeater, but they cannot be heard unless somebody activates them. And they stay active, you know, I mean, it's determined by the sysop, I believe, but they stay active for about 10 minutes, I believe, or 15 minutes, at least on the PAPA network. And the reason that they do this is, say you have a worldwide talk group. Well, there's probably going to be a lot of conversation going on the worldwide talk group because you got everybody in the world potentially on that talk group. And if that was active all the time, no one would ever get to use that time slot. So you have a dynamic talk group that allows you, once you key that up, then that talk group becomes active on that time slot until either it times out or, well, yeah, it times out ultimately. But every time somebody keys up on that specific repeater, it will keep that that dynamic talk group active. Does that make sense? This was a little confusing to me. It took me a little while to wrap my head around that.
Yeah, kind of.
You know, since you can only have the 2 conversations going on simultaneously because you have 2 time slots.
Right.
If you have a talk group that's really broad, you know, there's going to be a lot of conversation going on.
And as long as you keep talking on that one,
it'll keep it open.
It'll keep it open. And yeah. Is there some, it, does it expire? You know, is it like 10 minutes or an hour?
Yeah, well, I think it's 10 minutes, at least on Papa's network. That was 10 or 15 minutes or something like that. And then ultimately it'll shut itself off if it doesn't see any activity from you.
Right.
Now, there could be activity going on in
elsewhere. Japan. Yeah, it'll keep talking.
Yeah.
And then you'd have to go back and reconnect to it if you wanted to get back to the group.
Basically you just go back onto that talk group, you key it up again, and you don't even have to say anything. You just, once it sees that there's a signal there from you, it'll start listening.
Right.
But it'll take up that time slot, so anybody else there won't be able to do anything.
And when you key up, it'll send your call sign, so you should probably put your call sign out too.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that legally you're supposed to do that. But if somebody's in the middle of your conversation and they're already talking, you can't really jump in and put in your call sign. Right. So you can key up. Slot. You're hearing somebody talk. You're going to want to then key up again later when there's a moment there to just put your call sign out there. I don't really know the etiquette, you know, but I, legally we're supposed to give our call signs when we key up. So
right.
At least I believe we're supposed to, or you know, maybe not. Oh,
I think this all falls all. I believe it falls all the other rules of amateur radio. So
yes, hold on. I got out of my my thing here. I gotta go back to my slide. I hit the wrong key. So 1 second, jumped way ahead. Okay, hold on. Sorry, everybody.
That's all right.
We already talked about that. We talked about talk groups. That's okay. All right. Apparently, if you hit the shift key, it jumps all the way ahead.
To the end. Well, that's not good.
Well, not my problem. Okay, so we went through all of this.
Yep.
You guys got the quick slide there of all my contact information if anybody wants to get in touch with me.
Yeah, we'll put that up at the end.
That was sort of my intention.
We'll fill your email box with questions.
Oh, good. Okay, transmitting and receiving. So I put that graphic up earlier that was sort of showing the complexity of this. I tried to simplify this a little bit with some graphics here. So when you're transmitting, you've got your time slot, and there's two of them. I'm just going to show you one time slot at the moment, but you've got time slot one or time slot two. Within that time slot, you have your channel that you have set up inside of your code plug. Within that channel, you're going to set up your criteria, you know, whether you want to be able to transmit all the time or whether you only want to transmit when somebody else isn't talking. And you're also going to tell it what time slot that channel is going to be associated with, which will depend on your talk group. Does that make sense with the channel? Kind of. Yep. I'm trying to, I'm using the Russian dolls analogy. Yep, you know, this is within another thing. You then have your frequency, which is going to depend on the repeater that you're trying to connect to. And you're going to have your contact, which is essentially just your talk group. It's in your software, you'll have digital contacts, and you're going to go to that setting, and you're going to build a whole bunch of different digital contacts, each of which is just going to have a talk group associated with it. And I put the little star TS there to basically say you need to be aware of the time slot that that talk group needs to be on, otherwise it won't work. So if it's, you know, supposed to be on time slot two, you need to know when you build the channel that that's the time slot it's supposed to be in. It doesn't really have to do with your contact, which to me it would make more sense in the software, and maybe certain radios have it set up this way. When you build your contact, you tell it what talk group's time slot it is. Mm-hmm. But in the software I've been using, it actually is part of the channel that you set up the time slot. You got to set up your color code, you know, your PL tone essentially. And then once you've got all of those things set up, you can send some audio, and the audio signal will be, you know, hidden underneath all these abstract layers of settings. And it's a similar thing for receive. You have your time slot, and this is all still going to be in the same channel that you're setting up. You're setting both your send and your transmit, and your receive is all set up within this channel abstraction. It's going to have a receive frequency just like analog. There might be an offset there. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you might need to set it off by a few megahertz or something like that.
Right.
You're going to have a receive group, which I'd mentioned earlier, is basically the talk groups that you want to listen to on that channel. And you can do more than one.
Right. This is where you could have a whole bunch of them.
Yes.
And get really confused.
Yeah. And really throw yourself off.
Yep. Okay.
You know, but hey, remember, this comes from a commercial background. So yep. Maybe, you know, in some office building, everybody wanted to listen to the security channel or, you know, in case there was an emergency or something like that. But they only really wanted to talk on the whatever group they were with. And, mm-hmm. You know, maybe it was the parking lot attendants or something like that, and they needed to talk amongst themselves, but if there was a fire in the building, they wanted to be able to hear that.
Management wants to be able to monitor everything.
Exactly. Actually, that's probably my guess is management wanted to have a receive group that had every talk group in the building.
Got it.
And then they could only talk to other managers so that they could, you know, make decisions on people's lives and livelihood. and then within that, you get your audio signals. So, you know, receiving is a little less complicated. I don't think there's a color code associated with receiving. It's really only for transmitting. Mm-hmm. So I didn't add the color code in there for receive. Does that kind of make sense?
Yep, I think I'm getting this.
Okay. And then anyways, this was the graphic I showed earlier. It's essentially what I just showed you, but it shows both time slots.
Times two. So this is my conversation and our conversation and somebody else's conversations that could happen at the same time.
Right.
Got it.
Right. Okay. Repeater networks. We're getting through this. Brandmeister. Brandmeister is the network that Pop is associated with. So we're all on the Brandmeister DMR network. It was started in Europe, but it has a presence around the world, obviously, since we're in California, and that's what Papa decided to do. That's their website. And they have a really cool thing called the Hose Line. You can go onto the brandmeister.network website and go to their Hose Line, and you can listen to any conversation. You can, without even having a DMR radio, you can kind of log into a specific talk group and just listen to what's going on. Yeah, see on there, they got the Hose Line. And
you got to be registered though for this to work.
No, right? No. Oh, I think anybody can just go on. You're not logged on, but theoretically, if you go.
So I'm going to pull this up here.
Yeah, pull that up.
And
go to repeaters.
Go to repeaters. Full report.
Yeah, why not? And then just because there's a bazillion repeaters, maybe go. Oh, there should be a search that pops up there.
Here, I'll go to last heard. Okay. See what's in there.
Yeah, it takes a little while to populate. The Brandmeister website is not the fastest thing I've ever been on. But yeah, you can go and a lot of times you'll just see a little speaker icon.
As with all live demos.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Okay. Well, let's go back to your
we'll let that populate. We can play with the hose line later.
Yep.
And then the other one that I'm familiar with that I've heard about, the other major DMR repeater network is DMR Mark. And that was started in the USA. I don't have a lot of experience with them since the primary repeater I use is on Brandmeister. Mm-hmm. But you can get more information about them by going to the DMRmark.net website. Okay, Simplex. This is something that I really don't know what you're supposed to do. So I put frequencies to use, check your local band plan. So I don't want to get anybody in trouble. Make sure that whoever you are doing this with, that you check with your local band plan. So with a lot of question marks around it, this is what I gathered from what I could find on the internet. And as you know, everything on the internet's true. So, you trust everything, right?
Yeah, it's all Al Gore's fault.
Southern California, you are allowed to, and this is actually, I'm understanding this because this is what I was researching to figure out how to set up my, my hotspot. They suggest using frequencies between 431 and 000 and 431.050. The frequency, the spectrum the bandwidth, excuse me, is 12.5 kilohertz for a DMR transmission. So if you were looking at it on a spectrum analyzer, it'd be 12.5 kilohertz wide. Mm-hmm. So they basically say space it out, starting at 431 by 12.5 kilohertz. So it, when I was reading some forums, they were saying, well, it's safer to start at 431.0125 just to give yourself a little room from any spillover from, the stuff that's below it. Like we're using 431.500 or something like that. Actually, I'll have to
look. I think we use 431.500.
Yeah.
So you're way over I'm what they recommend.
Yeah. Got yeah. It. Well, as I said, I've read a bunch of stuff that tells you to do a bunch of different things. So I set up mine. I think I meant to put it as 050, and I probably put it as 431.500. So, decimal place, mistake there.
Got it.
Talk group 99 is for Simplex. So if you're trying to, talk to somebody on Simplex, go to 99. And then keep your admin and your in-call criteria to always. I guess that really doesn't matter because you can't really do anything if somebody's on that channel anyhow. I haven't done any Simplex, so this is just kind of throwing it out there. If anybody has any better suggestions, please let me know because I'm trying to figure it out myself. And hotspots saved the day today because we were not able to really get to the local repeater.
Yep.
Something to know, they're not exclusive to DMR. They work with DMR, D-Star, P25, Fusion, and other modes simultaneously. using a firmware called Multimode Digital Voice Modem, MDVM. And it's actually available on GitHub, so people can go in and check it out. But like the hotspot we're using right now, I can have it be a hotspot for, you know, the Yaesu Fusion, Yaesu Wires X or whatever, uses Fusion and yep. DMR and D-Star all at the same time.
And it was cool because you just brought it here. You didn't really do anything other than just plug it into my network and
yeah.
It worked.
Yeah, I just, and then you needed to know the frequency that we're, right. You know, we were using. And it's a little DIY project. It was kind of fun. I went over to HRO yesterday and, you know, put down my $100 and I got myself a little pie hat. And I've got like 10 Raspberry Pis just sitting around my house. I keep buying them every time I walk through Fry's. I have a problem.
Because they're there.
Yeah, exactly. Like, oh, I can, you know, I'll build a little camera with this one and I'll, you know, make a little music player with this other one. But it requires a Raspberry Pi. Now, something I just realized yesterday, the latest, greatest Raspberry Pi, which I think is the 3B Plus, it did not want to play nicely with. I loaded the SD card with the Pi Star software, and I put it in that Raspberry Pi, and it just blinked. But then I went with an older 3B, not the B Plus, but it's the regular B, and it worked great. So, unfortunately, with the B Plus, you get 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi on it built in, which is why I wanted to use it. It gives you more, you know, options.
Yep.
With the B, you've only got a 2.4 gigahertz Wi-Fi. So, if you turn on your microwave or whatever, your DMR network might go
down. You probably don't need the extra bandwidth that you're going to get from the 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi. It'll probably work on the slower one.
It works great. It's just the interference. I mean, I literally have a microwave in my house that as soon as I turn it on, our baby monitor turns off.
Yeah.
You know, it is terribly, terribly shielded. I actually have something that we were going to look at later, which is my tri-field meter, and it has a microwave sensing on it. And as soon as I turn that on microwave, it goes all the way to the top. And a couple of the Pi hats that you can get is the DV Mega, which I think is pretty popular, but it's expensive. If you want to have all the features, it's like $300. So they have another one called Blue DV that I just saw. I didn't actually research. The one I bought was ZoomSpot, ZUMSPOT. It worked great. It was $100. It only goes on UHF, but I mean, it's DMR and you're talking within, you know, your house or something. So you don't necessarily need VHF, UHF, everything else, you know. Oh, it looks like you got the
it's popular here.
You got the Brandmeister thing. Yeah, this is a good time.
So yeah, so I got looking at the Brandmeister screen now, and
so you see there's the little icon there with a speaker on it.
Yep.
So if you click on that, that'll take you to the Hoseline website.
We're gonna break the internet.
Well, of course. Okay, maybe not. Okay, there it goes. And if somebody is talking on it, and you agree, right?
Yeah, I'm good with that.
Yeah, you just gave away all your data. It's fine. Unfortunately, now nobody's talking.
Now they stopped. Yeah. They knew we're listening.
Yeah, exactly.
They're watching my show.
You guys are live on the air. You can hear us. So, well, anyways.
So I guess in theory, we could go back here. Is the hotspot hook up to the listen here?
Yes, it should, because I have it set up for Brandmeister. So
I put up my call here, where are we gonna?
Yeah, give it a shot.
This is Whiskey Zero Delta Hotel Golf testing on my DMR local hotspot.
I
slid off the screen.
Flew right by there.
Yeah.
You can narrow search. It down by, yeah, just type in like local, see what happens. We're experimenting here on the air.
Yeah, it's all good. Nope.
No. Okay.
And we can call. You do call sign, right? Did it get my call sign? No, it has no idea who I am.
If you're registered with Papa, it should. I'm not with Papa. Excuse me. With Brandmeister.
No, I haven't done that yet.
Oh, okay.
Actually, I tried to do that, and I think it's still checking me out.
Okay. Yeah, it takes some time. It takes like, I don't know. They took a couple days to get me in the system too.
No sweat. Okay. So back to your.
Anyways, theoretically,
yep.
You would be able to listen to people, and you don't even need to be registered. There is a pre-built hotspot. I saw the OpenSpot Shark RF, but apparently it's been discontinued. And for $600 price point, I see why it's been discontinued, because I can go build one for $135.
Maybe they'll come out with a $300 one.
Yeah, maybe. But, you know, right now I went on Amazon and I saw this Tugo one, or Tugu, I guess. It says Tugu for MMDVM, and it was $100, and it comes with the Raspberry Pi and a case and everything. I was tempted to buy it, but I didn't think I'd get it built and set up and everything in time for the show. So, and as I said, I'm glad we had it, because otherwise we wouldn't really be
we wouldn't be
operational today.
Yeah. To goo, huh?
And again, with the frequencies to use in Southern California, this is what I found on the internet, and I did it through, I'll go to the website later. Yeah, you can use between 431 and 431.050 with the 12.5 kilohertz spacing, and don't do what I'm doing, which is using 500.
Oh, well.
we're not hurting anybody.
It's low power in my garage here. So it's
only 10. Yeah, it's only 10 millivolts, right. Something like that. So it's milliwatts. Yeah. It's not going. But your radio is more powerful than that. Theoretically, yes. It's up to 5 watts. So
right, and I think I'm set on low power, so hopefully it's lower than that.
Yeah, but well, yeah, I don't know if mine's set up that way. Either way, I hopefully are not hurting anybody. I'm not hearing any noise or anything on this channel. So for the limited, you know, time of demo here, we should be fine. You know, for elsewhere, check your local band plan. It's really, you know, that simple. You just got to figure out what they allow digital transmission on. That's sort of my presentation that I came up with. Hopefully cool. This helped out.
I think it helped. It helped me. I'm getting more and more of it every day.
Yeah. And again, this is, you know, I'm a new ham. I actually just got started in January. So I, you know, there's my disclaimer.
Seems like you're doing all right. So yeah. There was one more screen you had after this.
Yeah. I gave you guys some contact info.
How do we find you?
Well, here. So my email, you can get me at my call sign at ARRL. I've got a personal website, which is projects.mixmonitors.com. That's where I, you know, got my little blog about building tube amps and all that kind of stuff. I think I'm going to post this up there as well.
Sounds good.
My business is sonicfreak.com. It's Sonic Freak Technologies. I'm a broadcast engineer and I do a lot with audio. So, that's where you'll find my business stuff. You and I are the system admins for LAMCOM, Los Angeles Emergency Communications, .org. We update that website. And then our Facebook, or my Facebook page, which is /SonicFreak on Facebook. And you can, and there's also a LAMCOM Facebook page too that we work on. We're working on it.
We're working on it.
Anyways, so there we go.
Very cool.
Fade to black.
I was awesome. So I'm going to take us off that and bring us back live in the studio.
Great.
With our lower third here. This is the show. Remember, 399 and 3/4.
Awesome.
Can't wait till we have to rev up for that before Gary gets back from Hawaii.
Yeah, I'm glad I'm on 3/4 and not 7/8 or, 9/10 or whatever else.
It's going to keep growing.
Yeah, I know. I know. I did actually want to tell you guys how I recovered from my issue.
Yeah, I'd love to see that.
My radiodity. So I actually have the page up here if you want to check it out.
Oh, yeah. Let me put that back.
So like I'd mentioned before, if you do a factory reset on... on this fancy radio here, it will basically offset the timing. And so I searched far and wide. I dug through my code plug. I, you know, actually even contacted the guys at Papa to make sure I'd set it up properly. And you know, their tech support's great. They got right back to me and they're like, "Hey, everything looks good," which was very discouraging. So I did some deeper digging and I found this guy here. This website's really cool. It actually tells you how to manipulate all kinds of things within this radio. I mean, you can do things like, you know, things that are probably not so legal, but you can up the transmission output on the channel and burn your battery up and destroy your radio if you want to as well, physically. But this actually was really cool because it was corrupt data after a factory reset.
So I guess this is a common occurrence. People do this all the time with that radio, such that somebody had to come up with this website.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you look, I can scroll up here a little bit, but see, there's all the different. On the left here is the hex.
The location. In memory. Yeah.
And so you've got things like, you know, I don't know. There's a lot of unknowns here too, but let me see if I can find something. So like high RF power output setting for 155 megahertz, you know, caution, high settings will burn out electronics.
Right.
You can really brick your radio. Luckily I didn't do anything that major, but yeah, members.optuszoo.com.au. You can find a lot of information. If you just type in, you know, bricked GD77 or, you know, I did a reset on my GD77. The Facebook page for the GD77 is actually really, really helpful too. They've got a Facebook group that has a lot of information there. So this was super helpful. I went through this whole setting, all these steps and downloaded the hex editor and I had to download my flash and reload my flash and change some hex stuff. But it worked and now I've got it working. I'll never do a factory reset again because that was what apparently did it to me. And then radioid.net, this is where you get your radio ID. This is very important. So yeah. If you haven't registered your radio, go and do it. It takes about 24 hours for them to get back to you.
Yeah, actually, it was a little shorter for me. But this was definitely the part that I had missed, and it wasn't really clear on the, our Papa System's got a really good DMR support, but this part was a little bit mystery for me. And I think it was like less than 12 hours. I did it in the evening, and by the next morning, I had in my mailbox, here's my number, and put it in there. And then once I figured out that Parrot was set up wrong, we were talking.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and it's one of those things that I think people just sort of think is obvious that you need this radio ID, but it's not. And, so anybody who's listening now or watching should, go here as soon as possible and get their radio registered so that they can be playing.
And it didn't even really care what radio I had. It was really about taking your call sign.
Yeah.
And I think what they do is they check to see, just like they do with the DMR or Echolink or whatever, they just check to see, do you have a valid call sign? Does it match your name? And then you're all good to go. So if you're thinking about getting a DMR radio.
Yeah. Even if you don't own one, just go ahead and register.
Yeah. Register and sign up and they'll get you an ID back. And then once you get your radio in your hand, you'll actually be able to program that number in.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. And then, shout out to Papa. This is actually where I learned a lot. They have a really good page on popassist.com/DMR.
Yep.
It's sort of the DMR basics. They tell you about repeaters. They've got this really great DMR 101 page. They've got a bunch of code plugs pre-set up for you, so you don't have to go through all the craziness if you just want to get running. And then their help desk, if you're, you're supposed to be a member. I think they give you 90 days on their network.
Yeah. So, Papa is a membership, a group.
Yeah. Both of us are members.
And I've been a member for a long time and all basically you can go and visit and join. And for 90 days, you get a free membership and they'll let you kick the tires for all the things. And then after 90 days, they just start bugging you to join because it's member supported.
And you know what? They're really great. When I was, that was the first time I got on the air was on their new ham net, and they don't require membership for that. And it's, I think, Wednesday nights or something like that. It was really, really helpful. Their DMR 101 page was really good. And you can also look just for an example of talk groups. These are the talk groups that they have. And you can see here's the time slots. Here's the segment, here, this one's California. It's on talk group 3106. There's 31061, time slot 2 has the Papa group, the SoCal group, local. And so if you notice here on the bottom, it says static and dynamic. The ones that are highlighted in black are their static talk groups. And the ones that are not highlighted are their dynamic talk groups. And like I was saying before with the static and dynamic. So if you have a static talk group, it's active all the time. So
it's always stuck there, essentially.
Yeah, so if you tune into your TG3106, if there's a conversation going on the California talk group, and that's a static talk group, you're going to hear that without having to do anything. You're just going to tune to that talk group. You're going to hear whatever conversation is going on. So they kind of got to be careful of what they pick to be static talk groups, because if there's a conversation going on California, well, then call zone 6 here can't talk because they're both on the same time slot, right? So these are two static talk groups on the same time slot, which obviously means that there isn't a ton of conversation going on simultaneously between these two, or else you'd never have a chance to get a word in edgewise. Because if somebody's talking on California, you can't talk on zone 6 or any of these. The dynamic ones like North America, Worldwide, TAC 310, those ones, USA, they have them as dynamic talk groups because, there's a lot of people in North America and they might all be talking all day long. And if that's the case, then none of these other talk groups will be available to talk. If you have conversations going on throughout worldwide, then, you've used up that time slot. And the way they seem to kind of do it is they've got more local conversations going on time slot two, so Papa, SoCal, and local. And then they have bigger, wider ranged talk groups like the entire state, you know, the country happening on talk group one. And I think that's sort of just the way things are done. I don't know if that's the way it is on every repeater network, but at least on Papa, that's how that is.
Got it.
And here we can take a quick look here. This is the dashboard of my PiStar. And this is actually showing us all the conversations that are going on. You can see there's your call sign right there, which means I believe you must be registered with Brandmeister, because I don't think it would have showed me your call sign.
I did send in the registration. I didn't get to get logged back into it, but okay. I sent in.
Well, it figured out who you were.
Yeah.
But you've got, you know, here's the time that it was transmitted. Here's the time slot. Now, with hotspots, it's always to slot two. Because you basically have your own little repeater, you know, and I don't know if we can actually show this. So
we could probably show it if I show the, here, I can do that. Here. Hold on. I'm going to switch over to your camera. Here's the Darren cam. Right. The guest cam.
Here, if you can see this, I don't have a case for it yet. It's raw.
Yeah,
it's actually I ordered one on Amazon. The one that's pre-built that you can get like this actually is built on a Pi Zero, but there's no Ethernet on a Pi Zero, so I wanted Ethernet, which means I had to order a special case for it. So there's a Pi 3B case on its way.
So the hotspot is just the whiteboard.
Yeah, just a little whiteboard on here. You can see there's a GPIO strip here on the Raspberry Pi, and you just plug that in there. And then you got to build your little flash card here too.
So it's a hat.
Yeah, it's Pi hat.
Got it.
But yeah, you can see it's the size of a Pi Zero, so you could do this all in, you know, a little pocket size Pi.
And you were able to download the image and put it on that micro SD card.
PiStar. PiStar is the image. Mm-hmm. I think it's a company from the UK. I'm going to put this back over here. Okay.
So one of the things, so we showed that hotspot.
Yeah.
One of the things we wanted to do, show the radios. So
yeah, yeah.
What do radios look like? So this is the one I got. I got the MD380.
I've got the GD77. So here's this guy. Yep. I don't know if you can see.
And they are a little different. Like mine has, I think I have to. Mine's got a color screen and all the bells and whistles, and it didn't really make any difference. I couldn't make it work until I had your help. Not that I was trying that hard, but
fair enough. It didn't work. This one, well, that one you also didn't brick when you tried to reset it. So
I will tell you honestly. There was when I did get it out, and after I got the I got it. Because Gary mentioned he had one and they were getting cheap and it was like $80, and I'm like, $80, I can buy a radio for $80.
Yeah, break that for nothing.
Yeah, and it does stuff that I can't do with any of the other, you know, $80 radios that I have or $100 radios. So I got it, and everybody said, oh, DMR is really hard. You won't get it to work and it won't work. And so, you know, I'm kind of techie guy. So I got it home and I had it out of the box and I plugged it in and I went to Papa website and I pulled down the code plug, and this was about 3 months ago, 4 months ago.
Yeah.
And I was listening in 5 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now I didn't figure out how to transmit for months until you came along and said, oh, we got to get an ID for that. You get the ID? I didn't get the ID. What ID?
Yeah. The code plugs are useful. I mean, yeah, you know, if they're totally set up, easy. You know, all the stuff that I was talking about in the presentation, really, you know, if your code plug works and you've got your radio ID, none of that really matters. I mean, it does, but that's if you really want to know, you know, all the inner workings of things like that. But yeah, if I had not bricked my radio, I wouldn't have learned about all of those other features in, you know, and how all they, you know, interacted and sort of this abstract layers of everything. Because I had to go through every single one of those settings like 50 times to figure out that they were all right. It was actually something completely unrelated that broke my radio. So,
right.
You know, as I said earlier, nothing like breaking something to learn how it works.
Well, and I thought about it because for the MD380, there are a whole bunch of like firmware upgrades, right, where you can get it to show you different screens and add other functionality.
Play video games and stuff, probably not.
Yeah, I know there was some weird stuff on there, and I started to think, well, maybe I'll pull one of those down, and I held back for now because I thought maybe it'd be better if I just get the thing to work.
Yeah.
Before I start trying to kill the radio, and now that I have it working, I'll probably try to kill it.
Yeah, yeah.
Or maybe I'll get a second one and goof around with that one, because I think I could add to my amateur radio activities by playing around with this, and I thought I actually have an extra mount in my FJ that I may put this in there. And I think the hand mic, this is just the standard Kenwood hand mic thing. So I put a hand mic on it.
I think you can even get like a Baofeng one for, you know, $5.
Yeah, I like the better quality one.
Yeah, I know.
But I might put that in there and just see like what other stuff I can do DMR driving around here and there and everywhere. And
it also does analog, which is one of the reasons I got this one instead of that one. Is that one's I believe UHF only?
Yeah, it is.
This is a dual band, so right. It will do UHF, VHF. So you can program in all your, you know, you can build a channel in your software that's just an analog, you know, just traditional.
When I was at Umaham Fest, Cecil had me that far away from buying that radio because he was there and brought along the portable repeaters.
Yeah,
and he wasn't selling them, but he was pushing them from whatever vendor was
this
there.
This specific radio,
that was the one. Interesting, because it did the dual band.
Okay,
and I guess that's it's a benefit for anybody that takes this radio, which for the most part is only good for me for DMR.
Yeah.
Yeah. And takes it to the point where you have it, where you could also work it in as, your quote unquote MCOM radio, which does, UHF only, and then you could add DMR on top of that.
It does really well for analog. I've tried it out, and you know, I've been told this radio actually sounds really good. The first time I ever keyed up on DMR, the person I was talking to, I don't remember their call. They told me though, wow, what radio are you on? It sounds great. And I, you know, said, well, the Amazon special.
Yeah, and then they said, no, it sounds
terrible. They're like, oh, yeah, it sounds terrible now.
No, so next time you get to tell them it's that one of those $8,000 Motorola radios, exactly. And then see what they say.
Well, you know, and there is something to be said about, you know, a better quality radio. I mean, you know, what I've heard with like these Baofengs, and I think this is a Baofeng company, and so it's the same manufacturer. You know, you get a lot of spurious emissions. Yeah. It's spilling all over the place. So technically, that's why they don't have them certified as, you know, FCC. But you know, get yourself in it. When you're going to break something, you might as well break something cheap, you know?
Yeah. We get to play with stuff, and that's part of the benefit of our licenses. We can try stuff out and make it work and not make it work. And
that's why I love this hobby, is I get to learn more.
So one of the things you wanted to show was, I don't know, there was something on the PC interface.
Something on the PC interface. Well, I mean, we can go to that. I was going to just kind of walk you through.
All right, I got to bring up your PC interface. Yeah,
no problem. And let me actually go start a new one here so we don't have one, because mine is very convoluted. So here is the software for this radio, GD77. Yep. Now you can kind of see all the things I was talking about. I'll go through all these menus really quickly. On this one, you can set your frequency range.
I'll show you that this one will do UHF and VHF.
Yep. And this is where when you boot it up, it will show you, you know, whatever you want on the screen.
Right.
That's more of just an ornamental thing.
Yeah. I always tell people, you know, put your call sign, put your name. That way somebody picks up your radio and turns it on, and they're like, oh, this is just somebody's generic radio. Oh, wait, no, that's Darren's radio.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
Now, this is definitely, and you can actually set a power on password too, which is probably good if you're, you know, got kids around or something like that, that you don't want them playing with your radio. Oh, I've got a 4-year-old.
Yeah, see, I want my kids to play with the radios.
Yeah, well, I know you do, because your kids are...
they're licensed.
Yeah, they don't put them in their mouth.
No, I guess that's true.
my 1-year-old will eat this radio.
Yeah, that's not good.
Although, no password is going to stop that from happening. So,
But he won't be able to transmit into his head if there's a power on password.
That's true. Yes.
Probably
a
good thing.
Yeah, you won't hear him eating the radio. Yeah. Anyways, you've got your menu settings. This one, there's this thing called double standby. Does that make sense to you when you hear the word double standby? Are you familiar with that term? Because I wasn't either.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah.
So this radio lets you monitor two frequencies simultaneously if you want to. That's what they call double standby.
Yeah. So we call it something different.
In the analog world. Yeah.
Right.
Both of us are probably blanking on that one. But it's, you know, dual receive. Dual receive, yes.
Right.
If that's a dual receive,
right,
make a lot more sense.
Yeah, exactly.
That threw me off for a while. I actually set mine to off. Or I don't even know what double single means. This is very confusing.
So I know on some of the radios I have, like my Woshan, the 8 models are true dual receive.
Yeah.
So you can listen to both at the same time.
Yeah, and this will do that. This radio does.
The 6 models and below, and I have some of those too, will do dual watch.
Okay.
Which means it'll go on one, and when it stops transmitting, it'll switch to the other, and when it stops transmitting, it'll go back and forth, but it won't do both at the same time. And I bet that double single means it's just looking back and forth between the two.
Skip that would make sense.
Skip your skip your skip.
Yeah.
And so then that way
talking over each other and
yeah
you exactly. Only hear one at any
time. You only hear one at any time, but at least you can be kind of listening to both, and then you got to pay attention when you look at the radio to say, "Hey, I'm hearing the bottom one, but I'm set to talk on the top one and switch over to that one."
Yeah, so especially with talk group or receive groups and when you can put multiple talk groups within your receive group, right. Having double that even makes it more confusing. So I turned that off, but it was one of those things that took me a little while to understand that that's exactly what that meant. You can set number keys on here for like hotkeys. General settings is important. Right here is where you put your radio ID, and that's important because it will not let you transmit with 0001.
That's the important one that I'd missed.
Yeah, that's kind of the key. And then I put for my radio name, I put my call sign. I guess you could just put it whatever you want. There's a whole lot of other settings in here, different types of scanning. Talk around is actually something from the commercial world that I believe allows you to do some sort of simplex operation while on a repeater. I'm not 100% sure. There's other things in here. Tone alerts for all kinds of different ways that it's going to indicate things. Vox sensitivity.
Vox is bad.
Yeah, I don't use Vox. Yeah. I actually have a little invention that I'll bring on the show one of these days. Yeah, later.
I think your idea for Vox is good.
Yeah, we'll keep that between us for the moment. But when I've got it working, I'll bring it on there. Anyways, you can do more button. This one actually has a couple of custom buttons on the side that allow you to bring up hotkeys and stuff like that. There is a whole text message thing. You can set up pre-built text messages, and then there's some privacy features in here. I haven't played with all of these settings yet.
So it's like encryption code. So if you want to talk to somebody,
which we're not supposed to do because it's ham radio and you're not.
We're borrowing from the commercial. Yeah, world.
Exactly. They gave us all the functionality, and especially with some of these, the Chinese made radios, they don't hold back. They don't have any reason to not allow people to do it.
Oh, I'll tell you one thing that was really amazing to me when I got into the software and looking at the software from your radio to my radio, it's similar but different, but it's pretty close. I will tell you, this is not what I come to expect from the Chinese software.
No, it's
this is even better than some of the Japanese software. Yeah. It looked like somebody probably took something that was here in the States and stole it.
Yeah.
Right. And ported it over or copied the code or whatever.
You realize these settings are useful.
It's not only is it useful, but for the most part, other than the double standard, double whatever thing, the menus, there's a lot of information on the menus, and for the most part, they make sense.
Yeah.
And it is way over. I mean, there are way more screens on here than.
There's a lot, and there's a lot of layers within layers and settings and sub menus, and again, there's a lot of stuff here from like this emergency system. I think this is all again from commercial radio. I don't really understand what the use of this is. This is the DTMF, which is your side tone.
Yep.
A lot of settings here. Nowhere have I seen anything that relates to MCOM or anything like that using this specifically other than that talk group. But, this is probably something that's useful to somebody. Right.
Though I know there's some there's a stun kill features, and I never understood that until somebody explained it to me, which allows you to program a radio so that with a code that you send DTMF, it'll actually disable the radio.
Oh, wow.
Right. Okay. And that's useful for commercial radios because if you're in law enforcement or fire or just, have a building based radio system and somebody gets a hold of your radio and then they start, the spurious emissions or whatever.
Trying to play jammer.
Yeah, exactly. Then, you can go out there and say, that's fine, but I'm going to key that, six digit code and kill your radio.
Okay.
And then that way they may still be able to hear, but then they can't transmit anymore.
That makes sense.
Right.
That makes a lot of sense. And actually that would be much more useful in a commercial. Well, I can be useful in amateur.
I don't know anybody who really uses it in amateur radio, although I did also see in one of the Reddit forums where people were saying, hey, if you're pulling somebody's code plug for a DMR radio or even a D-Star radio, you got to be really careful about what they put in there because they can put all this stun kill features and your admins can block you out. And I'm thinking, if your admin's putting up a code plug for their repeater, you know,
they're going to lose business if they're going to screw your radio up.
That's true, but I also might want to have the ability to say, you know, we have problems with our local MCOM net where we get jammers in there. Yeah. And you know what? If I was the owner of that DMR and I knew I had a quick way to be able to say, kill, you're out.
Totally.
I might do that.
Yeah. No, that makes sense.
And if you're smart enough to be able to go and look at the code plug and see that it's in there and pull it out, mm-hmm. you're probably not a jammer.
Now that you mention that, I should probably look through my code plug.
You should probably look through your code plug.
This is just the generic one. This is not my code plug. I'll show you guys my code plug in a second and the 300 and whatever contacts in there. Anyways, just to show you. So here's where you set up your contacts. And these are just the preset ones. If I look here, you've got group call, private call, and all call. I've not used the all call yet, but I've used the group call. We make most of our contacts with group calls. And it's the name and the call ID. The call ID is your talk group. There really isn't any other settings there. So it's almost like contact and talk group could almost be used synonymously. Mm-hmm. You need to set up your contacts for every talk group, and I'll show you in a second with my thing. And then you've got your receive groups, which right now, since there's nothing in here, it would normally populate with all the different groups, and you can add as many of these as you want. You then name them. Your zones, so I'll go back to zones, but basically your zones will be all the channels that you want to include. So if you have, you know, your repeater has, say, 5 or 10 talk groups, but you have 300 channels, you really only want to be able to access those 5 or 10 talk groups. And then you've got your channels, and here they set up 32 sort of placeholders. But this is really, you know, the meat and potatoes is you've got your mode. In this one, as I say, you can set it up as analog, and then this sort of is your settings for what we're talking about here. We want digital. You got your send and receive frequencies, your criteria. So like I was talking about with the admin criteria, you've got always, channel free, and then color code, which is based on the, you know, quote unquote PL tone. When I set my radio up at first, I did channel free, and I never got to really transmit when anybody else...
Couldn't talk to anybody.
So I set it back to always. I don't know if that's the right thing to do. Then you've got your digital settings here, which is really the most important thing. Your receive group. With the GD77, it's something to know that it's not obvious, but you have to have a receive group to hear anything. So if you just set up your contact as, you know, contact 1, 2, 3, whatever, it will transmit, but you'll never hear anything. So you need to go back in, make a receive group that is associated with that same talk group, and then put it in this list, or it just won't work. And it might be the same on your radio as well. I don't know. Your color code, you know, here's your numbers here, probably going to be 1 or 2 or something. And very important, your repeater slot, which is your time slot, you know, 1 or 2. And that will be associated with the contact or the talk group that you have set up. And then there's a bunch of other settings in here that, you know, you may or may not want to play around with. There's Vox. We never want to play that. You can set up scan groups. So, you know, like this one has scan V, where it'll just scan between these 16 channels. So my guess is when they have scan V and scan U, they're talking about VHF and UHF. So you got your UHF channels here. And then there's a VFO setting in here that you can change, you know. Again, I haven't played with all these things. Let me open up my code plug here so that you guys can see. So here are all the channels. And it goes on and on and on and on and on. There's a bunch of reserve channels. One of the things you can't do with this radio is rearrange things. So the person who originally set up this code plug actually put in a bunch of reserve channels.
Not alphabetical order.
Yeah, exactly. Right? You can't do any of that. Once, you know, if you have STG and you want to use something else, well, it's going to be at the end of the list. But yeah, you can see I've got countless channels here. It's like, I think it's like 300 or something like that. Anyways, it goes on and on. But let me go back here to, here is our local, so SDL is the Saddle Peak repeater. Here's the receive frequency. It's got an offset, so the transmit frequency is different. I've got our admin criteria to all, always. And I set it up in the PAPA SDL scan list. So if I want to just scan through the different channels on Saddle Peak, it'll just kind of cycle through those channels. I had to set up my receive group to local and my contact to local, and it's on slot number 2 with the color code number 1. And I'll go and show you guys the contacts themselves. So here's all the digital contacts, which are essentially just the different talk groups. Since we're looking at local, let's just look at the local one. It's talk group 2. And same thing for receive. I'll show you the receive group here. I just have the one member in it, which is the local member. And then we got our zones here. You got a bunch of different zone options, but since we're looking at Saddle Peak, we'll look at our Papa Saddle Peak zone. And it's just these channels here, you know, from here to here. And it's basically, here's the different talk groups that are associated with Saddle Peak. And so when I go onto my radio.
So if you look at those, let me see if I figured this out right. So if you look at those, like local is just Papa. So Saddle Peak is Papa 4, right?
Right.
So it would just be the Papa 4 repeater. And then that's local. And then 2.
Well, no, actually, I think local is a talk group that it goes amongst all
the Papa.
Yeah.
So how is that different? How do you think that? So the second one is Papa.
Right.
So I would think that would be all of the Papa ones.
Yeah. So these are both on the same time slot, local and Papa. I think it's just sort of. I don't really understand the designation, but everywhere that has talk group two is designated as local.
Got it.
Maybe it's, again, I'm just speaking off the top of my head here.
We'll reach out to those.
Yeah, we'll have to figure out.
Clue us in on there.
kind of a little more ourselves.
And then after that, you get SoCal and SoCal 1. Those are Southern California ones. Yep. And then obviously California, and there's two different groups for that.
Correct.
Zone 6, 6 land. So
I guess, yeah.
California. Again.
Wherever, yeah. Well, I think it incorporates more than just California.
Six land.
Oh, right, because of it's in our call signs. Yeah,
you can't see on the map behind me.
Yeah,
yeah, 6 land is California.
AJ6BL. Yeah, got it. Yeah, makes
sense. And then NA.
It's not on
national.
National.
Right.
Yeah.
And then world, and then NA wide, whatever that is. And there's your MCOM one.
Yep.
And then some other ones, including Parrot.
Yeah, yeah.
And time slot 1 and 2. And so those time slot 1 or 2 have to do with what Papa has set for those two time slots on that repeater.
Right.
And then you just get whatever the default ones
are. Yeah, if you just want to monitor everything that's on time slot 1, you can do this. Now, I haven't set these up again. This code plug was not... I didn't build this originally. I kind of used this as a template.
Yep.
And if you look at the time slot ones, there's actually no... Oops, I'm changing it. There's nothing set for my contact or my receive group. I think that the person who built this just kind of used those as placeholders in case you wanted to put something else on time slot 1 or time slot 2. You can make your own talk groups. You don't have to use the pre-built ones. So that's my guess, is that they just kind of put it in there as a placeholder.
Got it.
Yeah. Where was I? Was I on zones? I lost my place here. Okay, yeah. So yeah, these are and you know, you can add anything else in that you want. You can make a zone that's all of the SoCals from all the different repeaters. You know, it doesn't have to be specific, but you know,
it's whatever channels. So, so you start with the available channels, and you had to pre-program those or pull them in for somewhere else.
Yeah,
and then if you decide, hey, you know, I want to have one that I can dial through, and I'm going to flip over to my radio really quick because this was one of the things that I thought was interesting, and we'll see if we can see this or not. So, one of the things that is good, bad, or otherwise about this radio. Is you've got this local, can't see that. Can you see that? Yeah. And with the way the radio works, I go to the menu and I can pick whatever zone I'm in, right?
Yep.
And I'm going to go back because I want to stay in the one I'm in. And the dial on the top, at least my radio, only has 16 different clicks.
Oh, okay. So,
mine doesn't spin around.
Spin. Okay.
No, so mine only does the 16. So, you know, on this one, I got Papa, SoCal, 1, 2, 3. And then the one eventually at 16, which was the one we programmed for your hotspot. That's the local one, hotspot local. And so I could see if I'm using this all the time, based on at least the way my radio works, I'm going to always use these 8 or 10, because I can't imagine using 16, but you never know.
Yeah, you know.
And make one separate zone that has the ones that are important to me.
Yeah. So you're on SoCal all the time. And have lots of conversation. All your friends are meeting up on SoCal.
Right. But every once in a while, I want to flip over to like the workbench guys, I want to listen to the MCOM channel, or, you know, maybe, you know, my boy's off somewhere, you know, doing a service project, who knows where. And there's a D-Star or a DMR radio repeater there that you could hop onto. I might put it on there so that I could just flip back and forth without having to go to the menu. Because the menu on this is kind of frustrating. And so, you know, I go in there and I pick the zone. And if I hit the dial, then it switches me back to the one that I was on. And I would find myself using the dials on the top more than I would.
You know, that is a funny functionality of yours, that as soon as you switch that dial, because I would.
Yours doesn't do that.
No, well, mine doesn't. Mine only has volume on it. It's not, it, you know, it doesn't have all the same.
It doesn't have all the same stuff.
All the same stuff.
All right, Cecil, you were right. I should have bought this radio when I was at Yuma.
Yeah. Well, I actually really like yours for a couple of reasons. One, it doesn't break as soon as you reset it.
Well, I mean, I'm not really sure. I may not have done that yet.
That's probably true. But yeah, I think that the menus on these things, they kind of make sense. It's just nice to know how the software works. Then you kind of go through the menus. You see things that are familiar.
Right. And I assume like once I play with this enough, it will be more... It will be more natural to me, and I'll get used to it.
I mean, when I first opened up this thing, I was just like, what is all of this?
Well, you know, this makes no sense. It reminds me of, and I know that this is kind of an offshoot of, it reminds me of in the 90s,
mm-hmm.
I had a Nextel phone.
Yeah.
Right?
The push-to-talk feature.
You had push-to-talk, and then all the other channels and whatever on there, then you could program stuff, and it kind of reminds me of that. Even the menus look very similar to that in the way the interface works.
No, I actually remember using those Nextel phones a lot. I was working for a company, actually a buddy of mine and I started a company where we built recording studios, and we'd be, you know, one guy would be up in the ceiling somewhere pulling a cable, and, you know, I'd be on the ground or vice versa, and, you know, those phones were really handy to just say, hey, you know, pull or let go or whatever it was, you know. So I remember those phones well. I think Apple's actually incorporating that into their next iPhone software as a push-to-talk functionality. Which we'll see how that goes.
They're gonna put a button on the side.
Yeah, I know exactly. You're gonna go back.
They took all the buttons away.
They took them away, and now they're gonna put one back.
Be a digital button on the front that you push the button. It'll just be a picture button.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see how well that works out. Anyways, is there anything else? I think for me, that's it.
For something I wanted to do.
Okay, what's up?
I want you to hold up your radio and hold up my radio.
All right.
I want everybody to see this thing actually works.
Oh, yeah, totally.
So I'm on the local, we're just talking through the hotspot because we don't want to bother everybody on the Papa system. Yeah. And you know.
Although theoretically, you could listen to us on the local talk group on the hose line or anything else, but we weren't able to get that to work, so who knows.
Not yet. But here, you talk.
Okay.
And I'll put up the radio.
Alpha Juliet 6, Bravo Lima, testing 1, 2, 3. Well, that worked really well. Awesome. Not.
Did I change something here?
I don't know. Let me double check that I didn't screw something up here. Okay, I'm on hotspot. I'm on local. I hear the buzz through the system. This worked really, really well.
Oh, Whiskey Zero, Delta Hotel Golf on the local hotspot.
Okay, so yours seemed to work. Mine did not. Let's give this a try again.
We bricked your radio again.
That very well could be the case. Alpha Juliet 6, Bravo Lima.
It's one of those things like live on Facebook or on the air. It never works. But that was pretty cool. And you know, so you can see there is the delay.
Yeah.
And that was one of the things about D-Star that was a little, you know, different than analog. But it sounds good, and I know it's hard to tell, so talk again, and I'll put it up on the mic here.
Alpha, Juliet 6, Bravo, Lima, testing 1, 2. And, of course, it stopped working. See, so DMR is hard.
Put up to yours. Yeah, just like audio is
here,
hard.
Here, take a listen to this.
This is Whiskey Zero Delta Hotel. So there's a little bit of R2-D2, but it sounds the quality of the sound sounds pretty good. And I know this is like from the radio to the mic and through the mixer.
Yeah, I mean, whatever, if we had it direct out of the radio or whatever, it would probably sound a lot better. And then I also think because we're transmitting so close to the microphones, you're getting a little bit of a warble in there.
There's a lot of equipment here.
Yeah, it's picking up stuff. But anyways, I think it's hilarious that now all of a sudden mine doesn't want to transmit and yours does. But hey, that's cool. It was the opposite this morning.
Yeah.
Sometimes and, you know, it's a learning experience. If it was easy, it wouldn't be fun, right?
Yep. Sometimes this technology stuff is hard, and that's why we get to play with it. And that's why we're just getting started. I should have called this show, like, DMR training wheels or something like that.
Well, we can you know, circle back on this when both of us have a little more experience and we're like, oh, guess what, that thing we were trying to figure out, that was easy, we just, you know, forgot to flip some switch somewhere.
And I'll tell you, I've been watching the Facebook group and Bud Turner's provided a whole bunch of information.
Oh, cool. I haven't really been paying much attention. Apparently, I wanted to, but I didn't get a chance to look over at the chat group.
Apparently call signs aren't in the DMR data, and I think I knew this,
No, it's going to just be the radio ID.
Yeah, yeah, the radio ID is embedded in there.
But when you register on Brandmeister, or your, it will give your call sign. Yeah. So like when I'm looking at my, let's see if we can look at here. So if you look at my PiStar, it actually is showing the call signs of all the people because right. I think they're...
Because it's registered, it's tied to your call sign. And right. there's that database that we registered in that you showed in the beginning where you sign up.
Yeah.
And all you got to do is figure out the radio call and then plug that in.
But before I was actually registered on the Brandmeister network, it was actually just showing the radio ID.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
So... And you can, I think you can chase somebody down through figuring out what the radio ID is anyway and look on QRZ or whatever and, you know, figure out exactly who they are.
Got it. Show up on their door.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. that's really...
Okay, I totally blew really this.
you were looking at
it.
Was
on the wrong screen. No, we're looking at us. So this is the screen that he was showing.
Yeah, so I was just saying that it's showing the call signs here. These guys were on TAC Group 310. And it's actually showing their call sign. So if I click on mine, it will take me to my QRZ page, which I need to log into. Oh, actually, so
there we go. Like, you're logged in.
Nice little photo of me and stuff like that. So yeah, you can kind of figure out who's doing what. I won't click on anybody else just to keep their names. Well, I can click on you. Let's click on you.
Yeah, you can click on mine. I'm not innocent, and I don't mind about being private or whatever.
Oh, you look so happy right there. Okay, look, there's David.
Yeah, I need to update this a little bit, but that's all right. It's not too an old outside. My truck was washed there.
Yeah, yeah. So there you go.
So you can click right in there. That's very cool.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, these people aren't on my hotspot. They're just using that TAC group. And earlier, I think we were tuned into, I was tuned into that, so it was kind of activated for a little while. I accidentally keyed it. I think you can see me in here somewhere. And yeah, all of a sudden it was, you know, giving me all the conversations on TG 310.
Yeah, you're on the second line.
Oh, okay. There we are. Cool. The other thing there's lots to talk about with DMR. We can go on and on and on. This is actually kind of a high level conversation in the grand scheme of things.
That'll be another show.
But I did want to show, you'd mentioned on your last podcast.
Hold on.
Yep, no worries. I'm with you.
Wait, there's more.
All right. You'd mentioned something on your last podcast when we were doing field day. I got to do my first field day. It was really fun. David was a wonderful host and taught me all kinds of stuff. Helped me out with my first HF contacts and everything. But you'd mentioned the tri-field meter. And this is something that I discovered back in my roadie days. Technically, I wasn't being a roadie at the time. I was trying to fix something in somebody's studio. And it was a guitar player. And his vintage, you know, really expensive single coil pickup, I think it was a Fender, not a Strat, I don't know what it was. But anyways, it was something really expensive. And you know, every time he turned it on, it would just hum like crazy. We couldn't figure out what was going on. And so I ended up calling over an electrician. And the electrician brought this guy out, and he basically turned it on and goes, oh my gosh, you got a crazy magnetic field in here. You know, something is miswired. We need to go through your electrical. Well, it turned out that what had gone on is that this client of mine had a sauna, like a spa or whatever installed recently, and they just decided to wire it into his sub panel that did all the studio stuff.
Right.
And sure enough, it's got a, you know, big 60 cycle hum going on in there because this, you know, heater is running, trying to keep the water hot. Well, we rewired and it was fine. But the thing that I got from that, this has been a really, really interesting tool. And what it basically does is it senses three different types of fields. It senses magnetic fields. Here, let's bring it up a little closer here if you can see it.
A little higher.
Okay.
There you go.
So you got magnetic fields, 0 to 3 range.
Yeah.
Magnetic field, that's the wrong way.
0 to 100.
0 to 100. And you can see there's a little bit of magnetic field there going on. 0 to 3 is going to probably go a little higher.
Yeah. Electric.
Electric fields, you know.
Yeah.
And then you've got microwave. Yeah.
Radio.
So radio. If you key that. Oh, yeah. There it goes.
Ooh. Wow. So let's see. So if I come back a little bit. Yeah.
Yeah. It's good because it's DMR. It's going to stay transmitting.
I can even hear it.
Oh, yeah. I hear it in there. The microwave.
You hear it ticking. Yep.
Yep. And so we used this on field day.
Wait. Hold that back up there. Does it?
Oh, yeah. It'll.
There's a little bit. I got to make it.
Yeah. That's not as bad as your radio, but let's see if we do magnetic.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Pegged it right out.
Woo. Now I'm going to read you something off the back of this because this has got a little disclaimer on the back. I don't know.
Be careful, you're going to die.
Well, what's really funny, and we'll show how much we exposed each other at field day. It says studies suggest that biological effects may begin or occur near 3 milligauss of AC of an AC magnetic field. Now, 3 is this setting, 0 to 3, right? So, right. You know, you put that thing next to your head every day when you're, you know, and it's at 3. Well, when we were at field day, we had it set to 0 to 100, and it was in the...
It was like pegged out the whole time. 50
to 80 range. I mean, those high tension wires were putting off quite a bit of EM.
Yep.
And, you know, I think it affected it affected some of our transmissions.
Absolutely.
Definitely some of the receive stuff, too. But this is a great little thing. I got this at Fry's. I think it was, I don't know, 40, 50 bucks. I'm sure you can get them on Amazon or something like that. I haven't seen them very often, but they're a really great tool. If you're a guitar tech or a roadie and you've got a guitar player complaining about how much buzz he has in his rig, it's really nice to say, well, here, check it out. Here's something you can see. Doesn't fix anything, but it definitely tells you, you know, what's going on there. And, you know, maybe you're too close to some, you know, electrical panel, or somebody has cut the ground off of their, you know, off their power cable or something like that, and that's causing some problems. And also it lets you see how poorly shielded your microwave oven is in your house when you turn on the microwave and all of a sudden the microwave goes flying all the way up to 100. But something I just wanted to share with everybody because, I don't know, I haven't seen a lot of these out in the field.
And usually I think what you hear somebody say is go get an AM radio and turn it on and hold it around stuff because you can get the similar, you know, feedback from that radio.
That's I mean, you can, you know, there's a lot of different ways to kind of get the same results, but this gives you a number that you can reference, and that's kind of a nice feature of it. But yeah, you'd mentioned it on that last podcast, so I thought I'd bring it to share with the class.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, thank you for bringing it along.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we're about an hour and a half in, I think.
Cool. We'll
probably call it a show.
All right.
And we'll work on some stuff for another show. And I'm working on my, let's see. So the next one needs to be 399 and 7/8. We'll figure that out later on. Yeah, 7/8
is a good number. Right?
So I'm going to jump into the pitch here. If you like what we're doing. Oh, nope. That's the part. If you like what we're doing, come visit hamradionow.tv. You can get it there. You can get us on your podcast feed. You can get us on Facebook. You can get us on YouTube. But come and visit and find Arvin, our chief financial officer, and click the pig if you want to help out. There are expenses for putting the show on, hosting and podcast feeds and all sorts of other stuff, plus new equipment to bring in and show you all about. So if you like what we're doing, please hop in there and join us. And thank you for supporting us through Patreon or through PayPal. And there's a new one, and I think it's called Zazzle or something like that. I'm going to add that pretty soon because there's no fee for either of us to use that, unlike PayPal and the other one. And thank you. And I'm, you know, we're making a little bit of money, and it covers most of my expenses every month, and I appreciate that. And I know people miss Gary. I miss Gary too, and can't do anything about that. But partly I feel like I wanted to keep this around because there are 400 episodes in the can. Some of the content I'm part of, but a lot of content that Gary provided, and I feel like I'm kind of keeping that legacy up. I know there's a lot of people that still go and watch the old Gary videos and comment that it was useful to them. So we're maintaining that, and Gary will be back for episode number officially 400, and I don't know, by the time I get there, maybe like 405 or 406, but it's whatever it is. I want to thank you for joining us. There's Darren.
It was a pleasure.
Darren's information.
I really enjoyed it. Cool. I really enjoyed it.
Excellent. And thanks for coming to my mess.
Oh, no. This is great.
The studio.
Less mess than my house.
The studio, as we call it. You've gotten to the end of a show before.
Have I gotten to the end of
a
show?
Have you gotten to the end of a show?
I have, but is there something I'm supposed to...
There's a special close.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't...
Yeah, it's okay. Nobody ever gets it. Very few people.
Only I didn't realize I was...
Only the return guests usually get it. Well, actually, some of the return guests...
I'll have to be a return guest, and then I'll know.
You'll get it by the end. So I'm going to call us out. I'm going to hope the Arvin thing works. It sometimes works, and it sometimes doesn't. And I got to hope that we don't have the echo effect because I see that other microphone thing isn't on, but you never know. Nobody said anything in the Facebook room. This was Ham Radio Now, episode number 399 3/4, getting started with DMR. I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG, and this is
Darren LeGros, AJ6BL.
Over and
out.
Got it. And that worked.
Yay.
Yay. Sweet. Thanks for joining me. We're good. We're still there.
Oh, okay, cool.
All right, I'm going to turn off the Facebook. Bye, Facebook.
Bye, Facebook.
Thank you, Facebook. Let's see, is there anybody in here saying anything in Facebook?
Let's check it out.
No, not a whole lot, but that's all good. There's still three people watching.
Oh, okay. Hi, three people. Thanks for watching us.
So I hit the streams off, and now I hit the unrecord button.